was quite a complex set of negotiations with claim, counterclaim, and also the purchasing of plant equipment as well as duty transfer in respect of the previous highways agreements and contract. So it's actually quite a detailed answer that you will get, which would be much more information than the accountancy folk would have in terms of their briefing to give you tonight. If you want more information, then we'll provide that briefing, and indeed the person who negotiated that is sitting in the back there. So probably that's a separate conversation.
Thank you very much.
Okay, members, item number five. First of all, can I thank Jenny for her presentation and for answering the array of questions for us. Okay, early impact on universal credit. Can I just remind members that workshops were held back in, you will recall, back in February 2018, a number of workshops, both internally and we also have some reviews that will be at those workshops. This report was agreed to be deferred from July's meeting. So I'd like to invite Nicky Dixon sitting here to give an update, please.
What I've done is, because this thing was deferred from July, I've just put together what I heard all the salient points covering sort of what's gone on from the different views perspective and operationally, and also what we're seeing with local JC Plus and people who are actually accessing universal credit. So hopefully the points that I'm raising will, I think, sit with concerns that are emerging out of the report, the Scrutiny report of July, and also particularly Appendix 2, just at the back where members were looking at suggestive actions. I think some of the points that I picked up in pulling together and updates kind of link with some of the concerns that were raised there, so they might be of some interest. What I've looked at first is really the digital universal credit update bulletin that we had at the end of August. It's out there on the web, it's for everyone to see, probably doesn't attract a lot of interest because it's pretty plain talking in terms of the agreement that we have for universal support with the DWP and around how we negotiate, how that's funded and the resources that we can do. But what I did pick up from it, to which you may be of interest, is that the June universal credit announcements, which are particularly focused on the report of the appendix at the back regarding people in receipt of severe disability premium, and concerns around the impacts on those people in transitional arrangements. They are actually going to be managed through for migration that won't end until 2023. So the people affected in that regard will be, I suppose, not pushed onto universal credit under the present arrangements until that managed migration is complete. Our welfare rights advisors that work closely with the benefit service that I'm coming from also observing that there's quite a bit of debate around some form of transitional support for people who have already been put onto universal credit prior to the announcement of these extensions of the transition. We've also learnt since I think last time that supportive accommodation following consultation will remain entirely with housing benefit and local authorities, which is pretty key. I'm thinking about how that's funded. That means that people in supportive accommodation will remain entitled to housing benefit, but will be funded in the usual way. So that's also going to impact on the future of housing benefit service and the case study, which is all part of what's being looked at here. I think a key point to mention is the migration to universal credit at the moment is what we call a natural migration. Been waiting for a long, long time for the managed migration programme to be sort of aired really. And the DWP in this update are actually saying that they will commence managed migration, and they have alluded to a schedule from 2019, which will mean that people on one or more of actually be put into a programme and moved across to universal credit, so that's going to impact on the numbers that we see locally in receiving universal credit instead of the legacy benefits. For example, if you're in receipt of housing benefits at that point, working tax credit, child tax credit, income support, and a couple of other benefits, then you'll be picked up in that programme. Small updates, universal credit advances for those people that are struggling in between making their claim and getting their first reward, which is a DWP payment, I listened to add. They are, as you know, able to make those applications online, which will be, I would imagine, a little bit more helpful to a number of people. There was an issue raised about corporate activities and people with particular difficulty claiming universal credit or perhaps managing their rental payments. And with a review, DWP review underway, and quite improving that process. And that's actually something which our welfare rights advisors had also flagged as a concern, so it's quite welcome then that that's in part of the upgrade programme. I think perhaps of particular interest, I know there was much discussion around welfare of people generally and what the council can do. The DWP actually have a welfare and local authority steering group, which they promoted again in this update. In terms of reference and minutes, can be accessed on gov.com, so that's something which may be of interest to members with those concerns. From the point of view of the front of house, I haven't got front of house colleagues with me here tonight, but we've had a look at generally what they're seeing from the sort of hotspots since the scrutiny workshops. Usual things, it's applying for universal credit, so it's those people who might struggle to apply, whether it's a digital capacity or perhaps vulnerability. Personal budgeting and again supported online access, because of course it's an online application. One Stop Shop managers are telling me that personal budgeting support, which is what they provide on behalf of the DWP and which is funded for, the largest group, unfortunately, of people failing to attend appointments are the people that are actually referred for personal budgeting support. So really, those people are probably needing most, but they're the largest group that aren't presenting. 25% of those who are referred by the DWP are attending, and 75% generally aren't. So there's quite a lot of work going on between our partnership manager, the DWP, and our one-stop shop management team to try and really understand why that is the case. We're complying with the Universal Support Programme, but is there something wrong in that and how people are being referred, and whether there is or there isn't, that's the sort of work that's going on locally to try and say how can we improve that. In the meantime, they're monitoring the people that don't need to, that fail to turn up, keeping in touch with the people locally over that, and then they're trying to contact the claimant to re-refer them and get them back through the process again. I think it's fair to say that whilst that probably doesn't sound hugely effective, it's a work in progress. They've started to do that in about the last 6 weeks. So we're seeing numbers ramp up since the Universal Full Service last November. And I think it's an incremental sort of good work in progress. We're just going to have to keep checking by it. Why aren't people attending? What can we do to support them to come along? And DWP have said that their working relationship with Wirral notably is excellent, and they're pretty encouraging of that programme continuing. In terms of the benefit maximisation, One Stop Shops are saying that when we do get some people with personal budgeting support, they are actually signposting discretionary housing payments, local welfare assistance, council tax support, because obviously we are concerned that there is take up of benefit. Advance payments as well, which is particularly the advance payment. And they are seeing an increasing number of people get that advance payment quite quickly after attending One Stop Shop. I haven't got things with me, but we can provide any data that's required after this evening. The most vulnerable customers are the people that I think, again, in an update, it's something that's been through from One Stop Shop to DWP, but they also concern noted in Appendix 2 to the July report. And their people who either have a barrier or perhaps appear to have a barrier to maintain work, find work, and be in work. It could be that they did have a challenge, or it could be what did reveal that the driving is a problematic state. So it's really dependencies, so perhaps alcohol and drug dependencies, serious health issues. And increasingly, one-stop shops are seeing that they work with partner agencies to refer those people for support. It may be that they need that support before they can actually then take the rest of the steps that are necessary through to get the universal credit claim in the way. They're looking at partner agencies such as Lifelong Learning, which is around digital and IT literacy, drugs and alcohol groups, and actually increasing the GP referrals. I think to sort of conclude the bits that I'm pointing out around the front of the house, what they're saying is they're managing at the moment with resources to meet the demand that is presenting. But I think if the numbers that the DWP are predicting when we look at our delivery partnership agreements ought to be coming across the doorsteps, then we may start to struggle. So that is something which we're looking at with the front of house. To have a back of house in my head to support that as well. And obviously, we'll be discussing the DWP and we'll sign up for the delivery partnership agreement next year. There have been some good news stories. I haven't got huge details of them here, but some of the sort of anecdotal bits and pieces that One Stop Shops have mentioned particularly important this evening were things like somebody that was in person budgeting support that was paying £30. £30 a month for their mobile phone insurance, which they saw as an essential expenditure. And it's understandable to some degree because everything they have to do is online and they may be able to use their phone for that. But in discussion with the advisor, they were able to get household insurance that was £8 a month that could have been a mobile phone. So there's lots of little nuances around what they're trying to do at that first point of contact. I'll just touch briefly on free school meals because I think that was a point that was emerging as a concern with regards to people being eligible for free school meals prior to the assessment or award of universal credit. My service at the moment maintains the free school meal programme, if you like, and the admin and the table for people premium, which is obviously income for schools as well as the council. We cannot award referrals prior to the decision being made in respect of a universal credit application. What I have pointed out in discussion with Scrutiny at the workshops is that the council has basically discretion to do that, but obviously it's how that's then funded. And so I think I'm raising that because we're not presently making an award prior to the universal decision notice. And so we can't backdate the award down there. With reference to welfare rights advisors and maybe increasing capacity in that regard, with the appendix and the recommendations, I'm just pointing out really we have a welfare rights unit, which really now is a small group of advisors, which I'm going to say, who are based in the benefit service. And it's really just a couple of things that they're noting around the key issues that they're seeing that people might be struggling with. And one which affects the council as well, which is the deduction from benefits. They're flagging that up. People who under an old legacy benefits, if they had perhaps a deduction for an annuity, bill that hadn't been paid. Sometimes that couldn't come out of their old legacy benefit, but increasingly deductions can be made from universal credit. And some of those deductions they're reporting can be quite steep. So that's the type of work that they're seeing coming in when they may be negotiating, making a change to those deductions. From a council tax collection point of view, deductions take quite some time to come through, and we're quite far down the pecking order, so it has a little bit there really. They're also saying, which is something that we're looking at the back of house, and it's something that we're looking at with peers in the Merseyside region, doing benefits and services across the region, is that earnings are quite often an issue in terms of people budgeting, and particularly monthly bills and their council tax bill, for example, because the way that they've been paid when they've been topped up with universal credit, they could be on 0 contract hours. vice versa around how we can look up, how we learn about with regard to the sort of learning pattern as to how people are getting their degree, whether it's really as credit and wages and what the pattern is for that income coming in and what's then going out. I'm probably hopping on a little bit too much here, but trying to link them to the key points that were there in the report. We are looking at a key area, which is the take-up of council tax support, and it is a concern. We've got less council tax support being awarded. The gap isn't because necessarily few people are entitled to this, but they're not applying as they move into universal credit. We've got housing benefit claim, which stops because the housing benefit or rent costs are met through universal credit, but that can't come from council tax support. And a separate claim has to be made. So there's a huge amount of activity front of house, on the web, to the call centre, and every call you've got to contact somebody to say, have you made a claim for council tax support? And it is briefly, Jason was working, organisers that were well briefed in that, and they've done a lot of observation work on one stop shops to try and understand how they can push people into that and support them into that help and how important it is. But what we are doing across the region is looking at what else we can accept as a claim and perhaps an intention to claim. So that's something which we're hoping we can do to really bridge, fill that gap and sort of that issue out, because it is becoming quite problematic. It's placing people in hardship, and if they've perhaps got 6 or 8 weeks or maybe more in council tax support they would otherwise have had. And of course, then we've not got the corresponding awards to assist with collection. From the perspective of discretionary support, so we can also local welfare assistance and discretionary housing payments. Increasingly, people in the city of Universal Credit are being signed up to be for discretionary housing payments because the council still retains the responsibility for supporting them with additional housing that are rental costs, whilst we've got the budget to do so. But particularly with local welfare assistance, the increasing pattern seems to be that it's awards in respect of food, household essentials, so it might be a shopping cart or supermarket. And after that, it tends to be furniture. It's notably increasing in food and sort of provision for shopping. And that's aside from 3 grand referrals. Just briefly, we always anticipated by now that we'd have to make the caseload really dwindled. But the Universal Credit Programme has obviously been quite significantly extended. We've got just under 3,900 Universal Credit claims, which are claims that receive the Universal Credit, the coffers, negative council tax support. Our caseload is reduced by about 2.2%. That's actually the highest across Merseyside, but it's not huge. So we're running with a caseload of about 36,000 at the moment across the benefits caseload. Obviously some of the things that I've said will impact on that, the fact that the supported accommodation is in slow hand, benefits, so what we predicted would be a quite a drop as managed migration and going to be impacted by the fact that supported accommodation claims will continue to be managed by the local authority. And operationally the impact is really the full-time equivalent of staffing resources to deal with the volume of work that comes through associated with people moving on to Universal Credit. And that's really it.
Okay, thank you very much, Nikki, for that very, very detailed report. Very thorough, I have to say. I'm sure it will spark a lot of questions. David.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you for the comprehensive report. It really is excellent. As highlighted in the FO, absolutely, obviously. But two relevant points that come out of this. You have mentioned one is in relation to the housing and homeless of 3.2. As an authority, we have 293 bed spaces for single homeless people at the moment, able to support them in the tenancy. Some of these are given out to families, but major limited to teenage parents. Do you think we will see an increase in full families at the end of this homeless situation in the future? And how can we help second point is the point that you related to in the free school meals, and it's a double whammy in the effect, because since they wanted to raise the threshold, increase the threshold, most people now be aware of free meals for the children. Once you want to universal credit, don't give it, and they will miss out on that. The other side of that is then schools miss out on the funding for people feeding. So really, it's a double whammy in that respect. I think something needs to be written by all members of the council to the LDA to put pressure on to look at these particular issues. And I can see this really escalating in the next few years. Thank you, Chair.
Anita.
Thanks, Chair. Thank you very much for your presentation, Nicky, and the report is very thorough. Some of the concerns that I have, you're reading reports now about 1 in 6 claims not paid on time for some people in the Zoom, using our food banks for some people into homelessness. And another area is with our veterans who are now becoming homeless as well. I've had two inquiries from veterans who are homeless. I've had an inquiry last week from two families who were homeless. So in answer to the question, yes, it's a situation which is really dire. What concerns me, Nicky, about what you said, and forgive me if I got this wrong, but I was astounded really from what I heard, where you'd said that the numbers that are presenting at the moment, you're managing with, but there's a large proportion who don't turn up for appointments,
yes,
and then you would be struggling.
I think there's two parts to it. Of the numbers that are scheduled for appointments, if you like, and referred by locally, it's a quarter of those people only who turn up. So I think year to date, 122 physically attended for their first appointment. The numbers that the DWP in our delivery partnership agreement anticipate we ought to be seeing come across our doorstep, if you like, is an entirely different number. So we can manage the 400 or so, but the number that they're actually contracting with us to see through personal budgeting support and paying grant to fall, if those numbers came to fruition, then we would struggle.
And just regarding our homelessness and the veterans who become homeless, have you got any comments on that?
I think I would need to take that back to Housing and Homelessness College. It would be really appropriate for you to respond on that.
Okay, can you certainly welcome any improvements to this dialogue system?
Thank you. It really is a very comprehensive report, and just to say thank you for that. There are, though, just in answer to your question, and to back Anita, there are families that are perhaps not even using food banks, but using some of the other services that are now available through our community centres, intercepted food, for example. And I want to give you a real life example because it really caught me up. I went to Hammond Square because I wanted to see for myself the number of homeless people turning up for food, for hot food, on Thursday night. And there was a father who actually turned up with his young son. That child had not eaten, let me tell you, because the father was making excuses saying, he's saying something, he's already had his tea before he came out. I fed that little boy cottage pan, and as he couldn't open his mouth quick enough to get the next spoonful. So I think that this, although this is a very, very comprehensive report, it's the figures that we have that are reported in. There's a lot of things going on that are not reported in, that need highlighting somewhere, and I don't know where that comes from. It might be that we write to the LGA, I'm not sure. But, so, Yeah, but there's a lot more going on that is getting unreported and is ignored. Thank you, Ben.
Chris, please.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you very much for a very comprehensive report and what you said. It's really, you know, very, you know, yeah, it's sometimes where to start, but that those basic brass tacks kind of points you make about why people are, you know, why you're trying to work out what are the problems, what are the issues, and get it down to the very specific things like people struggling with being able to have to complete an application form, or if they've got to remember login and passwords, some people have struggles with that, and that, even things like that, people get penalised for, and that's knocking back their when they're going to get paid. You talked about the personal budget support and only a quarter of people coming to those appointments and doing some work about trying to work out why. But then there's an answer on the case study, homeless single parent. She was sleeping on her sister's couch due to a relationship breakdown. She had a 5-month-old baby and she was attending college. Now in this case, this young person was given help, but if this is typical, which I'm sure it is, why people can't get to their personal budgeting sessions, I think the answers are here. It's a disgrace, and I think, you know, the worry is, as you're pointing out in a very measured way, as colleagues from all around here, all around the political spectrum, hopefully are realising this is a disgrace, it's a disaster, and people are going to die as a result of this. As a special grand cold winter. So we really need to do something about it. We really need to make our voices heard if we're not happy about this. Walking into an absolute disaster, we must make every representation we can to the appropriate channels.
Before I ask you, make you come back in, is it not the same issue?
It's just that I want to really, as the chair of adult health, care and health scrutiny committee. I wonder whether this might be actually a separate topic we could bring. I think this is very much within health. You know, it crosses over and might know what the health impacts are out of this as well. So I will pick that up.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Tell me first.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I've got a question as well, but a couple of comments about what Gillian, just said there. If the speaker would be missed, and you've got a responsibility that's actually being administered by the council and by local governments, so it's actually us who are missing it. It's not a government issue. But we can push it back to governments and say the rollout isn't working, but ultimately we're missing it. What I wanted to say is, it's around administration. So saying we're having to work with DWP, and obviously the job centre or whatever, without referring to it as job centre plus or whatever else, we're going to have to work in tandem with them. How are you finding that? Because I know when they actually first trialled this maybe 3 or 4 years ago, the job centre found that it was extremely beneficial because it was easier to administer. But obviously we're getting into the more complex cases now as we're starting to work down. It was the single male employees, which is pretty easy. So when you're actually trying to amalgamate, and it needs doing by the way, because people didn't have a clue what they were claiming, what they weren't claiming, whether they were overclaiming, then they get a back charge. So it needs doing, and I know it's painful, but it needs to happen. So you're looking at job seekers' allowance, housing payment, child tax credit, working tax credits, etc., etc., down the list. How are you finding working with the civil service? Well, is it working?
They have a really close collaboration. When we first went full service, we put officers in the back as best we could, given our resource, but over and above the every partnership agreement, we put some sort of pretty skilled housing management assessors into local job centres. So they support the ones, the work advisors, with regard to the other things that people might be missing out on. But they, in turn, as one sort of job advisors, were able to see what people were struggling with. Now that collaboration continues. We've also got a regional workshop which we'll be attending along with a number of the councils, where we talk to the more strategically to the partnership managers around what a Liverpool City region and our sort of being able to actually be seeing around all of these issues. And they are actually workshop based as well. So it's sort of happening at local level, because we've made that happen, but then through the more formal channels, regions, which we'll be going along to as well.
David.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. A hard question, really, that I have large swathes of my rather large, bizarre and awkward family who are scared stiff of computers and are scared stiff of coming to take advice from anybody on how to use a computer in order to make claims that they're legitimately entitled to. I wonder if you've got a handle on people who are just not claiming, if you're a percentage of people who are not claiming, because they're frightened of this process. I've got close relatives who will not use a computer. They're just frightened of it, and they're put off by the whole concept of having to present themselves to some third party and admit that they can't do it. I wonder if that is a relevant point, if there are people who are really not claiming because of those sort of fears of the technology involved. I think you just comment on that.
I think absolutely it's that knowledge, not just with regard to universal credit, but the whole digital programme. Children in schools using computers and are very digitally savvy. And then there's all the degrees in between. And what I know that we have a digital inclusion programme and policy as a council. That's not something which my service area is entirely responsible for. We've fed into it from our experience of policy dealing with hospital residents. There's a lot of work that goes on, again, up front of house. For example, the local work assistance claim, so not universal credit based, but which we administer, is an online application. But recently, we've had somebody that couldn't make their application because basically the system was crashing. There's a problem with it on that occasion. Only maybe for an hour or something like that, but we try and send those applications around within 24 hours because they're there for emergency support. So basically we call the person, they express that they can't get through, they're trying to make the application, they phone the office, they phone the call centre, and on that occasion we supported them over the phone to do it. I'm not saying that's perfect and it can happen in every case, but we will try and go sort of every which way to try and get that person to make the application, or we'd arrange them to be back at a one-stop shop. To actually call a library to have somebody sit in and work through with them. That's from our service area's perspective. More broadly, there is additional programme across the council which may be something that you might be interested in looking at, because the problem is wider than what I've seen as a quite just as you probably realise.
Okay. Just very briefly, Chair, the point I was trying to make, there are a number of people, and I'd say they are in my extended family, so I know them firsthand. I think that dogs are too old to learn new tricks, and they don't want to know anything about applying for services online or to somebody. In fact, there's one person I know who actually went without universal credit, and they actually went bankrupt because they're not universal credit, but credit in general. And he actually died virtually intestate because he didn't want to put himself through the intimidating process of having to apply for what he thought was help. Now, that's a dreadful thing to happen. We should not be allowing that to happen in 2018. I just wondered whether you had any handle on how many people who are entitled to claims are not getting it because they're too fearful of going through the process to get it.
There is a welfare, Liverpool City Region welfare impact report. And I think there's a lot of statistical information in that. I'm trying to think of the it was recently circulated across the Liverpool City region. It's a study that was, I'm aware of it, it was a study that was undertaken across all of the councils. Not had an active involvement in it myself, but I'm aware that it's full of stats and I would imagine it will cover the digital issue.
Okay, I understand you.
Sorry. I understand, through you, Chair, I understand you can't really answer that question, but it is a major concern to a lot of the people, including me.
That's a fair point, Dan. Thank you. Jane.
Thank you. That's a very complicated, truly comprehensive. I wonder what advice you give to me. I've had an email from a resident whose native language is not English. struggling to make an application for universal credit. And obviously it takes him so long. By the time he's almost finished that page, the page has expired and he has to go back. This is what he's saying in the email. I was about to get some advice for him from the council. An officer in the council, so I can give him the best advice possible. He obviously needs a call to do it with somebody. Would there be somebody in the libraries who would be able to help him, given that image is not his first language, for instance?
Yes, yes. There will be, I think the first thing to do is, I can help him with the details separately. Save you an email, but it would be the supported access that we're talking about, so it's really helping somebody sitting there and taking them through that process. That could be at one stop shop and all the libraries.
Thanks. And also, I wanted to ask, the post-scrutiny workshop feedback suggested actions. Very, very, very good suggestions. Has anything been done to take them forward?
So far, from my perspective, it's a kind of updated response. We're waiting for further instruction if we are to take those responses.
So where we go to, who's going to give the instruction on how to do with it?
Jean, can we get back to you on that?
Yeah.
Thank you. First of all,
Kathy. Yes, through you, Charles. I just wanted to ask you a couple of questions. I think it's a very complex issue, not just in terms of credit, but socio-economic across the board, really. It says the majority of universal credit claimants in Europe fall into the 20-29 age bracket. Is that because you're rolling out into that age bracket specifically, or is it that there are more people aged 20-29 claiming credit, universal credit towards benefits on the world that are actually in that age range?
It's linked to the initial rollout.
Right.
It was a very simple step by step.
To some extent, 20-29 year olds, I'm probably more techno savvy than say the likes of me, because I've used this. I feel sorry for anybody having to do it online, because I either buy six things on nothing, or like Jean said, the page expires, so I'm perhaps not the first one to admit, so I'd hate to have to be doing it, and God forbid I've never had to. Going on to another case study with the homeless thing, and I think this throws up or highlights the fact that it's not just about claiming benefits, but the fact that the sort of breakdowns in relationships in society generally. Because this young girl, she's 18, so she's a 5-month-old baby, she's living on a sister's couch. I'm assuming somewhere along the line, like everybody, she's got a mother or a father somewhere. Well, everybody has a mother, don't they? Well, she might be, but statistically, that she must have a mother and a father to actually be alive. Whether they're alive or not now is the material. The point I'm trying to make is that this is the idea, isn't it? That there's somewhere she should be a mother and a father, or she's got a sister, and she's got a baby that's 5 months. Where's the father? And also, if she's going to college at the same time, who looks after the baby? She says, I mean, these are very complex issues, aren't they?
Okay, that's not the job of policy.
The point I'm trying to make, there are lots and lots of individual circumstances, and this one case study doesn't really show the whole situation that in person, does it?
No, I think one of the points that one of the points that I picked up from the DWP update bulletin August, which I mentioned at the beginning, and perhaps this is linking to that, is the corporate appointee process.
Sorry.
The corporate appointee process. I'm not saying that's the answer for so many complex individual circumstances. But there seems to be an acknowledgement in the DWP providing this update that process isn't really as robust as it needs to be, and I think that's from the perspective of the DWP, and they're confirming my knowledge that it's actually under review, and they do flag up that it's for perhaps challenging cases, and it's very much a case by case basis, so how the local authority can be empowered to help people who are struggling. Perhaps that's a little bit more around that question.
I'm sure, and I feel sorry for everybody that's working in your department having to deal with cases, because it's only going to be complicated. And especially for those that you've got some of the learning difficulties as well. That's either, I mean, just to say that your girl here might have learned a different case for all I know. So the issues become far more complicated. So you have my deepest sympathy in your department for all the work, the harrowing work that you must do.
Absolutely, thank you. Anita.
Thanks, Chair. Mine's just really a follow-on from both David and Cathy's comments, really, in that, you know, obviously we do have people on access issues. We've got people who may be paying for a mobile phone, but we've got others that don't have a mobile phone. We've got others that don't have a telephone of any sort, don't have an email of any sort. They may have mental health issues, for instance, as well. We've also got a situation where we've got people on zero on contracts who, by the time they go through the process, if they come out of work, to go onto universal credit, then they may have got another zero on contract. So the numbers entitled, not claiming, is pretty significant, I think, as part of this scrutiny. You know, the time it takes to process, the fact that there's no backdating of this benefit as well. And people are having to choose whether they pay for food or they put heating on, which, you know, we're coming up to the winter now. And that really bothers me, that people are in such a dire state with no back pay, when they, through no fault of their own, that things are taking so long to deal with. You know, and I know we've got the welfare fund, and I know the charities that are helping out there, but even the charities now are crying out for help from somebody, because they're just breaking all of this. So I think as part of the recommendations, Chair, there's certainly plenty of scope for further scrutiny from all, you know, all around the tables here. But people are coming out with clear examples of where this system is failing.
Just a question, really, because I noticed on the introduction that the
switch on off.
The workshops, someone from the DCP was asked to attend, but were informed about the constitution to prohibit officers attending political forums. Now, I know this is a political forum, but I'm just wondering if there's any benefit in requesting, not coming through scrutiny, someone from the DWP to come along here and give us a presentation on their take on how universal credit is working in Wirral. Without question, to make it very clear, they're not here to be scrutinised, just to give us an update.
What's the last question?
Well, if they won't take part in the political debate, we can't press them. What we want to know is, we can hear from the council how it's working. We want to hear from the DWP how it's working.
Can I just say, you will recall that you did come along to that last workshop.
I wasn't in the committee last year.
They were there at that one. We certainly asked them to come along to the next one, without a doubt.
I think you should come to the
I think there's some, I might be wrong.